Thanks for coming. For those that don't know the Tuesday seminar, probably only you, so in this seminar you really are supposed to understand everything, which means, so please ask me whenever something does not make sense. So the title is signrank, VC dimension, and spectral gaps. And this is joint work with Shay, Moran, and Amir, Yehudayoff from the Technion. And basically all the new results are from the last 2 months, maybe. But it will be closely related to things I've been doing in the mid 80s. That's frightening, so almost 30 years ago. So I'll mention some of this also. So let me start with the definition of the relevant notions. What is signrank? So that will be a definition. So A will be a n by n matrix. Always I'll have a, I mean, everything I'm doing is good also for non-square matrices, but somehow I don't want to confuse between rows and columns. So it is. So this will be n by n, and it will be a sign matrix. So let Aij be in plus minus 1. And we define the sign rank of A, so we are allowed to change any plus to any positive real and any minus to any negative real. And we just want to minimize the rank. Okay, so that's the definition, sign rank of A is the minimum of the rank of B over all matrices B, so that, so maybe one way to write it is that Bij times Aij is positive for all ij. And let me show you one example, or almost show you one example. So here is an example. I want the sign rank of something that looks like the identity. So let me put minuses in the diagonal and plus everywhere else. I do it for a 4 by 4 matrix. And the claim is that this is a 3. And the reason it is at most 3, so it's more 3 by. So what we can do is we can make sure that the sum over every row will be 0. So let me put here minus 3 and 1, 1, 1. Minus 3. Okay, so the rank of this is, of course, 3. That's right, yeah. So if you want, that's a minus the Laplacian of a complete graph on 4 vertices. And as he said, although he talked about the inverses of them, they are always singular, so the sum is 0. And I'll not, so it's somehow a simple exercise to see that it is bigger than 2, but let me say something about it. It will follow also from some of the things I'll do later. Sign rank of this A. So this is A. Is bigger than 2, since otherwise, so if it is 2 or less, then we can realize it by lines and points in the plane. And somehow, because this is something I'll use later, I want to say it, although it's trivial. So otherwise, there are 4 lines. L1 up to L4 through origin. In the plane, and four points, also in the plane, P1 to P4, also in R2, such that the point Pj lies in the positive side of Li if and only if Aij is plus 1. So that Pj lies in Li plus, so that's a positive side, if and only if Aij equals plus 1. And this is because if the sign rank is 2, then we can write we have a matrix B, which has the same signs as A, and B we can write it as a product of a 4 by 2 and a 2 by 4 matrix, right? So this means that the rank is 2, so if we denote this A1, B1, A2, B2, and so on, and this is maybe X1, Y1, X4. Or 4B4, then exactly the fact that the signs are what we wanted them to be means that if we look at the line, with coordinates determined by A and B, and we look at this point, then it lies in the side that we need, and you can easily convince yourselves that, lines, four lines through the origin, there is only one way, right? So it only matters how they... Okay, let me choose the axis also. So these are four lines. And then you have to decide where to put the points. And you can check that you cannot put here even, this matrix is a Hadamard matrix. You cannot put even three points here so that the Hamming distance of the signs between every two will be exactly two. But, so this is just to say that it is simple to check. But I'll use this effect about embedding, and why would we want to look at sign rank? So maybe two main reasons. One of them is that sign rank is related or really determines, sign rank determines the so-called unbounded error probabilistic communication complexity of the matrix determined by the sign matrix. Unbounded error probabilistic communication complexity of a function, of the Boolean function given by A. So we think about Ellis as having a row, Bob as a column, they have to decide about the sign, they communicate with each other, and they just have to be right with probability bigger than half. We don't care by how much bigger than half. And then Paturin and Simon showed, this is in the mid-80s, that exactly the minimum number of bits we have to send is a log of the sign rank of the matrix. It's not so difficult to see, but okay. So this is one reason. Another thing, and I'll mention something about it later, is that it's related to a large margin. Let's say okay. So it's related to learning, pack learning. So related to large margin classifiers. Learning, so this is when we try in pack learning, we want to learn the rows of the matrix, and we try to do it by embedding it in Euclidean space. So somehow that's a common way to do it, and if we can do it with large margin, namely that whenever we have a hyperplane, the points that lie in one side and the points that lie in the other side are kind of far from the hyperplane, then because of Johnson-Linden-Strauss lemma, we will be able also to embed it with the same signs in pretty low dimension. So large margin corresponds to low dimension. Okay. is okay, this is sine rank. Now, what about VC dimension? So again, if A, so that will be another definition, that's about VC dimension. So A will be again n by n matrix of signs. And a set of columns, we will say that it is shattered. Okay, so I, this will be a subset of n. And I want to think about it. Maybe it's better. Okay, never mind. So set of columns. So this is shattered. If when we look at the projection on these columns, we see all the 2 to the I possibilities, okay? So means that for every J subset of I, there exists some row I, so that if we look at Aij, this will be, say, plus 1 if J belongs to J, it will be minus 1 if J does not. Well, belongs to I minus J. Okay, so this is, we see on the columns of I, we see all the 2 to the I possibilities, and the VC dimension, named after Vatnik and Chervonenki, so VC dimension of A, VCA will be the maximum cardinality of a shattered set. Of course, this cannot be more than, than the logarithm of the number of rows, right? Because we have to see all the possibilities. It can be much smaller. And the VC dimension appears also in many areas. So first, it is it has a central role. So VC dimension is crucial for pack learning. So it really determines how simple it is to learn a class of notions. So this was a result by Blumer, Ehrenfjucht, Hausler, and Wormuth from the mid-80s or late 80s. And basically, big VC dimension is difficult to learn, and small VC dimension is easy to learn, and really constant VC dimension means that we can learn by a constant number of examples. Okay, so this is in learning. Now, in communication complexity, it is related to the communication complexity we need under product distributions. Okay, so maybe here, so that this is where the notion is valiant, and then it's a Blumer. Ehrenfjucht, Hausler, and Wormuth in 86. And as I said, communication complexity under product distribution.
One way.
And it's even one way. And that actually follows from some of the results about VC dimension, but this is Kramer. Yeah, I guess starting from 4 authors, I'll write only initials. So, and Nissan and Ron. Maybe 90 something. Right, so somehow if the VC dimension is constant, then if we have this matrix and we have a distribution on the rows and distribution on the rows and a distribution on the columns, then we can say the right answer with probability 2/3, say, by sending constant number of bits in one way, just from, say, the column player to the row player. And, okay. So this is communication complexity, and it also appears in computational geometry and in probability or statistics, in combinatorics, and actually also in approximation algorithms. But let me just so this is just to say that that it appears quite a lot. Okay, so this is good. Still everything is written, so you can still read the okay. But
the VC dimension of A.
So the VC dimension of that matrix, of the matrix here, right, is one, because we do not have any two columns that are shattered, right? I mean, for a 4x4 matrix, the maximum it could have been would be two, right? Two only if we would see all the possibilities. And I should say that for VC dimension one, it's kind of well understood. So we have a nice characterization of all the matrices that have VC dimension one. But VC dimension two is already complicated. And we will see also that it will, that there will be a big difference between one and two here. So there will be. Okay, so, so let me do this. Okay, so one thing we want to understand is the relation between VC dimension and signrank. Somehow small VC dimension means that the matrix looks simple. Small signrank also means that it is simple, so it makes sense to believe that maybe if one is big, then the other can be big also. I mean, one direction is trivial, I'll not write it, that the signrank is always at least the VC dimension, because somehow if you have, you can convince yourself that if you have a shattered set of columns, they cannot be linearly dependent, because they cannot be linearly dependent. Yeah. Okay, it's simple to see. And we cannot say something more. I mean, it could be that the sine rank will be exactly the VC dimension, but we'll be interested in the other extreme. So let me denote by f of n and d. So this will be the maximum possible sine rank of a matrix, say A, where A is, again, n by n, sine matrix, and the VC dimension of A is at most D.
A typical matrix, what's
the sine rank? A random matrix. The question is, what's the sine rank? I'll come to that soon. It's going to be linear, and it will be. It's actually interesting to understand, and I think difficult to understand the constant in the linear. Maybe it's not so important for the applications, because in many of the applications you take logarithm anyway, but somehow.
So you don't want to compare the log of the sine.
Say that again?
The logarithm
of, you mean just in the definition or what? Yeah, you could, I mean, yeah, I don't. Yeah, so let's stay with this. Yeah, with the definitions like this, but if you prefer to think about logarithm, or you, if you want to take log twice, also, it's, I mean, yeah, usually in quantities, if you take enough times logs, then you understand them very well. Right? It's, so you can, okay. But I'll, okay. So one thing I want to understand is what could be the maximum possible sine rank of a matrix with VC dimension d. And I'm really thinking about constant d, so in that sense it will not matter so much if I take log or not. And this will be will have some applications to this learning and communication complexity. But let's just think about it combinatorially. So what is known about it? So let's also denote f of n will be, if we don't limit the VC dimension. So this will be just the maximum over D of F and D. So So the maximum possible sign rank of an n by n sign matrix. Okay, so that's a. Okay, so what is known? So we had this paper with Frankel and Redel, and this is what I said, that is almost 30 years ago. And basically, we showed that f of n is linear, so is at least, you can improve the 20, but definitely it's at least, and over 10, 20, it's at most roughly half n. Probably the truth is here that could be difficult. And I'll show you the proof. Actually, I'll show you quite a bit of proofs today. And all the proofs will be short, but they will use quite a bit of things. So they will use naturally linear algebra and combinatorics, probability, algebraic geometry, and some computational geometry. So there will be a lot of tools, but everything will be really short. So somehow it's okay. So so this is one thing that f of n. Could be big. Now, what about if we fix d? So that's also known. And I should say that this is counting. So far, this is for random matrices. There are no explicit examples that that are known that give something like this. And a similar counting is in a subsequent paper by Ben David, Iron. And Simon, maybe in 02, and they said that for every d which is at least 4, just before somehow, for very small, they still don't get anything, but this f of nd is at least, is big, so is at least n to the 1 minus 2 over d, minus 1 over 2 to the d over 2. Okay, so you see that it's pretty big. And again, this is by counting, no explicit examples. So one thing I want to show you are some new bounds here for this f and d. So the new, well, maybe the first part is not really new. So first, as I said, when the VC dimension is 1, it's kind of easy to understand what's going on because we understand all the matrices of VC dimension 1. And this is equal to 3 for every n, which is at least 4. And actually, that's also not new. So this is also in some old papers that we had with Hausler and Welzel in 87, I think. Okay, but we somehow give now a somewhat better proof, I think. But anyway, I'll not show this one. It's not so bad. What next? So fn2. No, maybe I'll first write something more interesting. So a general upper bound. So fnd. There was no upper bound. I mean, as we see, there cannot be a very good upper bound. But the general upper bound is that this is not more than n to the 1 minus 1 over d. And if I have two conjectures, the conjecture would be that this is tight up to a constant factor for every n and d, but don't quite know it. But at least for d equals 2, it's almost. So up to logarithmic factors, fn2 is at least omega of n to the 1 half. So that's the right thing, but we lose some log here. OK. And maybe I'd write also f of n3 is at least omega n to the 8. So a little bit bigger, 8 over 15 over log n. And so these are just attempts to try to get close to this. Fn4, the best we know, is n to the 2/3 over log n. And then I'll just write for general d. It could have been good to leave this. Okay, we'll see. So if nd is at least n to the 1 minus 1 over d, so this is what we would want. And then there is some correction here. This correction is pretty small, so it's 3d minus 1 over d cubed plus 2d squared plus 3d. Okay, so we lose something that is about 3 over d squared. This is for every d, which is at least 5. Okay. Maybe I want again to put the log n here. Yeah. The question is if I can write.
If you want to keep all of this.
Right. Yeah. I thought to keep it, but now I see that it's not in a good place. Right, but we'll see. So to keep it to the proofs, but maybe anyway I'll prove only this and that. So somehow I'll keep part of it.
These are
all by counting still. Yeah. So all these bounds are by counting, but you are saying how does it agree with random? Well, random D will be with high probability for random matrix, the VC dimension is about log. That's easy to see. So it's log.
It's
an absolute constant. You can. Right. Probably with 1/100. It's true for every. Okay. Any other? Good. So this is a. These are by counting, and of course, as is really the case in this area, we prefer to have explicit examples. So what about explicit? Until about 10 years ago or something, there was no explicit. It's easy to give an explicit example that needs signrank at least, forget the VC dimension now, that needs signrank at least log n. Because, for example, there are explicit examples that contain every log n by log n matrix as a submatrix. And now, because the counting tells us something about the. But there are other ways as well. Maybe we knew in that paper with Hausler and Feldzell, we knew that, that this f of n2 is at least omega log n. Explicitly. So it was just to have some example where it goes to infinity with n. But that's somehow very far from this. And a very nice result by Forster, that was the first. So he gave explicit bounds again with no, we don't limit the VC dimension, where the signrank is at least square root n. In fact, strictly bigger than square root n if you look at his proof. But so f of n, just the maximum possible signrank when we don't limit, is bigger than square root n. For example, so again, explicitly, and I'll say something about his proof. For example, for every Hadamard matrix, right? So, for example, the matrix, the 4x4 matrix we had there, is a Hadamard matrix. By what is written here, it is more than constant square root 4. if you look at the proof, there really is a proof with say also. For 4 by 4, it's strictly more than square root of 4. So it will give the 3. If we want to do it this way, we can. Okay. And there are no explicit examples that give anything bigger than, say, 2 square root n. You can beat the square root n a little bit just by looking at this proof. So the new thing will be, maybe I'll write it like this, explicitly, we would have examples, some simple examples, that would tell us that f and d, well, not quite as big as the counting thing, but it will be at least some power n to the 1 half minus 1 over 2d. We'll have many examples, although I'll show probably only one. You mean the specific Hadamard matrix? Yeah, so for any Hadamard matrix, the sign rank is at least square root n. But for some, for the Hadamard matrix that you mentioned, which is a tensor product of, the tensor power of this one, or of that one that I wrote there. So it's a sign rank, I'm not sure what it is exactly, but it's not more than n raised to the power log. You see, because the 4 by 4 had rank 3, sign rank 3. So by tensoring it, it means it's a 4 to the k by 4 to the k would have rank at most 3 to the k, sign rank at most 3 to the k. So it's a power, not necessarily square root, but some power. But it could and it should, it's probably true that for some Hadamard matrices, I don't know, the Paley graphs or whatever, maybe it's linear. We don't know, but it could be linear. So that would be nice. Ah, so that was the question? No, so maybe, okay, so I answered. So it was a too long answer to for a wrong question, but anyway, yeah, maybe it's relevant also. So the definition of Hadamard matrix is just one that A times A transposed is, so the rows are orthogonal, plus minus one matrix, rows orthogonal. And the conjecture is that those exist for any n which is divisible by 4. And it is known that they exist for many values, but okay. Good. All right, so in fact, this will be part of something more general, and I'll write it as a theorem, maybe now I'll write it where it will say. So this brings us to the last notion in the title, the spectral gap. So we still didn't have any spectral gaps. So the theorem about explicit would be the following. If A, so let A now be, it's convenient for me now to look at a binary. Not plus minus one, but so it's binary. And let it be D, well, okay, D, maybe I don't want to use D again. So delta regular. And what I mean by delta regular, it's not necessarily a symmetric matrix, but we have D ones in delta ones in each row and column. This matrix. This matrix has a singular eigenvalues, a square roots, a singular values. So the square roots of the eigenvalues of A transposed. And it's easy to see that delta is the biggest singular value. So delta is sigma 1, bigger than sigma 2, and so on up to sigma n. Be the singular values. So they are all non-negative, right? Because it's a square roots of eigenvalues of A transpose, which is positive semi-definite. Then the claim is it's a sign ring. Well, we don't have here a sign matrix. It's a binary matrix. So let's make it a sign matrix. So maybe 2A minus J. Okay, we replace a 1 by 1 and a 0 by minus 1. So this is a... So the claim is that this is at least a delta over sigma 2. Okay, we will have many examples where we have a big spectral gap where sigma 2 could be as small as essentially square root of delta. It cannot be significantly smaller than square root of delta. So it's again related to a to Dan's lecture yesterday, but
so the same boundary as for the chromatic number.
So if it's a if this would have been a symmetric matrix, then it's similar to the bound for the chromatic number, for example. Or for the ratio between the independence number and the number of vertices. So whenever we would take, a good expander, which would not only have small VC dimension, but it would be even very sparse, then we would have some reasonably big lower bound for the signrank. Okay, so this is so these are results, and I want to tell you something about proofs. So, maybe before. Let me say something quickly about this, about the application. So it will be just to plug in. The first one. So as we said, there are connections to communication complexity, to learning, and also to some combinatorial thing. So I'll just say. So the first one is that by an explicit example, there is a with a constant VC dimension. Because of this, with a one-way, if you want, communication complexity with respect to product distribution, which is O of one, because the VC dimension is constant, so that's a result of Kramer, Nissan, and Rohn. And if we want arbitrary communication complexity, but we want very, very weakly, we just want a tiny advantage. We just want to be correct with probability bigger than half. We don't care by how much. So an unbounded error communication complexity. So here we take logarithm, and because of this, any power will be just as good. So it's essentially as big as it can be, log n, right? So explicit examples of n by n matrices. So if you want of functions of log n variables, okay, maybe I write it here, okay, n by n. Right, so this is as large as it can be. There was some explicit example by Sherstov, but it gave omega square root log n. So this is bigger. This is, if we don't care about the constants, it's as large as it can be. This is one. The second is indeed about this pack learning. So again, they are explicit. There will be some very simple matrices. So there are explicit matrices that rows, I'll soon say something about it, can be learned in a O1 or with O1 examples. In the pack model, because again, the VC dimension is constant, but if we try to embed it in Euclidean space and to learn with embeddings, margins are small. how small, 1 over n to the omega 1, essentially. So again. And here, so if you want just to think, it will come later, but just to think about some specific example, to learn lines in a, in a finite projective plane is difficult. So this will be one example because it has a big spectral gap. So it means that the concept that we are trying to learn is one line in a given projective plane. And we try to learn it from examples. So basically, it says that if we try to do it by embedding, the best that we can do is, so we cannot do anything non-trivial. But the VC dimension here is 2. It's will be easy to see. And therefore, if we learn it in the usual PAC models, then it's very easy to learn. OK, and maybe finally I'll say something about counting. So let me just say that the number number of n by n matrices, let me do it this way, matrices with VC dimension D is at most 2, so it will follow from the proof, is at most exponential in n to the 1 minus 1 over d times log n. And I'm writing it because it improves, so we have some paper with, I said that 4 authors, I'm only saying initials. So with Balog, Bolobash, and Morris, this is from 2011, and we had there the same exponent, but a big power of log, and this will give something better, and it will, and the proof will be in a few lines, given something that. Okay, so now we want to say something about proofs, and as I said, proofs will be short, but they will use all kinds of things. This we don't have to end. Okay, so you mean what happens for 1D and what happens to another? So it's basically an increasing, the maximum signrank with a given VC dimension. So it's an increasing function of the VC dimension. I don't know any, no, so just if, the only thing that comes to mind is just the fact that it becomes bigger as the dimension grows.
Well, for instance, nothing about the generating function.
No, because, it would be nice maybe, but I think, again, it's a matter of opinion, but I think that all these things are kind of hopeless to really find exact numbers. So we don't really even try to enumerate things exactly, and usually with generating functions, I don't know. But, that's good.
So there's some linear upper bound of the side length of n catamount matrix.
So I'll be very surprised. You mean if for every, if I have to conjecture, I would conjecture that there is a Hadamard matrix for which it is not. So this is what I said. The upper bound is 3. For the tensor power, it is the upper bound is 3 to the k for a 4 to the k by 4 to the k matrix. By tensoring. Right, yeah. So it is sublinear, right, yeah. Yeah, and in fact, for any, whenever you have a Hadamard matrix, then the tensor power of it is also a Hadamard matrix. So starting from any matrix you want, you can get many examples. And it could be that we can find some matrix to start with, which would give us a better upper bound than this 3 to the k.
How hard is it to compute this signrank?
Right, yeah. So that I was kind of sure that someone will ask me, and I was trying to. So I was surprised that I didn't find anything about it. I didn't search too much, but it's. I'm sure it's hard. I mean, but I don't see a quick proof that. But I thought only a few minutes yesterday. So I don't see a quick proof that even that it's NP hard, or that it's. But should be hard. Should be hard to approximate. I'm sure. I mean. Right, yeah, but so normally I don't, I mean, as I said, I'm kind of sure that it is hard because you look at examples of 4x4 matrices and you really spend a long time, so, or trying to prove that for Hadamard matrices, so I'd be very surprised even if it's easy to approximate up to any, but I don't know to say anything clever about it. I mean, yeah, this is, and this is certainly related, right? Because, so if it's known that to approximate the margin is very hard to approximate. Okay, so then I think that by Johnson Linus Strauss, it probably should imply also that to compute the signrank. But, okay, so it could be, so we should check with Omri later, but there should, it will be surprising if good. So, and same, by the way, for VC dimension. I think that, I mean, of course, to decide if the VC dimension is 2 is easy because you can check all the, but I think that to compute the VC dimension is hard, seems to me. So to, again, I'm not sure if anything is known, but let's say to decide if the VC dimension is less than 1/100 log n. It's a natural problem where the complexity is not more than n to the log n because you can check all possibilities, but it will, okay. But it's, all right, so I want to say, to show you at least one proof before we make a break, because there is always a danger of not knowing who will come back after the break. So let's say, okay, so let me show you some proofs. And I don't, so if n1 equals 3 for all n bigger than 4 is omitted, I mean, it takes some time, but we know already that it's at least 3 because that 4x4 matrix that we saw had VC dimension 1, and then it has, but as I said, we kind of understand all the matrices with VC dimension 1. So now I want to show you, this is nice, I think, is upper bound. So if nd is at most n to the 1 minus 1 over d times constant, so this is for all the, okay. This will be short, but it uses something. So we want to use the following result by Felsel from the late 80s, and then there was some improvement by Chazel and Welzel and by Hausler. Really, this is to shave some, this may be 95, and this is in 89. And it says the following. So if A is again, A is n by n, and Aij, so it's a sign matrix, and it satisfies something which is called the small primal Schetter function. It's something that I'll mention that matrices with small VC dimension satisfy because of what's called the Sauer's lemma. But let me just say, and for every k, and for every set of k rows, of k columns, let's say, number of a distinct projections So it's a set B I on I. So just look, it's a set I, and we look how many distinct rows we get there. Is at most a, let's say, C times K to the D. C is some absolute constant, and D is also some constant. Then the conclusion is something, they call it trees with low stepping numbers. So I'll give an example. But so then there exists a spanning tree. Spanning tree on the rows. So this is just a tree whose vertices are the rows of the matrix, and it's spanning, so that every column is uniform. Well, I'll write it and I'll explain on all edges. On all edges of the tree, but at most this n to the 1 minus 1 over d. So does this mean, for example, if this matrix is the matrix that we saw before, kind of signed identity or signed negative identity. And we can take the tree, I can take here is just a Hamilton path, if you want, so just a path of length. So this is tree. And then if I fix a column, so what does it mean that I want to look at the edges of the tree, and I want to see if this edge is uniform. So this edge is uniform, in the sense that this column has plus here and also plus here. This edge is not uniform, this edge is not uniform. Right? So this is a, so here every column uniform, well, here it's a small example, on all edges, but at most two. Okay, well, two out of the three, but in this case, but also yesterday we saw epsilon, which was 2.6, right? So it's not always there. But anyway, so this is a statement, and let me show you how this is useful. So first, by this Sauer's lemma, indeed, if VC of A is D, or is at most D, then this estimate holds. It's a number of, I can call it like star. It's a number of projections, is at most, we know even more. So Sauer's lemma was, in some sense, it is proved also in the paper by Vapnik and Chevronenkis, but only with a little worse estimate, and then was proved by Sauer independently by Perls and Schellach. So many versions of this were proved by many people, and it's kind of interesting to note that Perls is the only one who proved it twice independently, really independently. Because he proved it once in this paper with Schellach in the 70s. And then after some years, Benji Weiss asked essentially the same question, and he forgot by that time, and he found a proof, a different proof. And I was a student at that time, and I also proved something related. I was talking to Weiss and showed him this proof, and I knew about the Sauer and the Perls Schellach, and he said that, yeah, but Micha just showed him this other proof, so you can even prove several times independently the same result. So by Sauer's lemma, we know that this holds, okay? So it means that there is this spanning tree with low stepping number. Now, I'm saying that in fact we can we can assume, if we want, that this tree is a Hamilton path, is a path. And this is because there are some old, these are also results from the 60s, maybe Chartrand or Sheehan, several people proved it. It's simple that the cube of any tree is Hamiltonian. Whenever you take a tree, if you take a graph in which two are connected, if and only if their distance in the tree is at most three, then you get something that is Hamiltonian. So it means that by jumping three edges at most at a time, you can make something that is Hamiltonian. By some triangle inequality, it means that that still this would hold. Okay, so as cube of any tree is Hamiltonian, we need only a Hamilton path. Actually, if the graph is two connected, it's a more difficult result. So if you start with two connected graphs, then the square is already Hamiltonian. It's not so easy, but so as cube of any tree is Hamiltonian, I may assume is a path, is a Hamilton path. So what does it mean? So this means that there is a permutation of rows of A according to the path, so such that along any column we have at most this n to the 1 minus 1 over d sign changes, because we go along the column and we just see the edges of the tree. So the sign changes not too many times. Okay. So now we can assign to row I, after the permutation, a point. So let me call this, say, the number of sign changes. Let this be S. So this is this number. So assign to it a point, 1, I square, and so on up to I to the S. So this lies in R, S plus 1, if you want. And to every column J, a polynomial. So let's give this point a name. So this will be Pi. Okay, and that will be to column J, we would have some polynomial QJZ, okay, which is QJ0 plus QJ1Z, plus and so on, plus QS, JZ to the S, which has the right signs on all the points. We can, because the number of sign changes is only S, so if I want a polynomial that will change sign where I want it to change sign, then I just make sure that these are the roots, right? So so that Q J of Pi is equal, the sign of Qj of Pi is exactly Aij. Okay, now this just gives us the two matrices. So one of them will be the points, and the other one will be the coefficients of the. All right, so if I take the matrix, say here is P1 up to Pn, and here I take the coefficients of the polynomials, so this will be like Q, I'll write it, Q1 up to Qn. So this will be a matrix that the signs are the correct ones. So the sign of this matrix is exactly the matrix A, implying that the sign rank of A is at most S plus 1, which is N to the 1 minus 1 over D. so that gives us the upper bound. And as I said, somehow we suspect that that's the truth. Okay, so let me, I'll just tell you in 2 minutes what I'm going to do after the break, and then you will decide how. Okay. So we want still to show the lower bounds. Now, the lower bounds are also very short, but they use something from real algebraic geometry, so we would need some tools that enable us to count the number of sign patterns of polynomials, if we know something about the polynomials, and we know. And then I'll show something about the explicit example, so I'll tell you about Forster, basically Forster argument, and how we how we modify it, and how it gives this spectral bound. Okay, so we'll take 5 minutes break, 7 minutes, yeah, okay. Uh-huh. Are polynomials in many variables, in x1 up to xn, let's say. The number of sign patterns. These are real polynomials. The number of sign patterns. Yeah, it will come, but now I'm just defining something, so it is defined always. So the number of sign patterns of p1 up to pm, so this is a definition. S, we denote it by S of p1 up to pm. So what are we doing? We take the sign of p1 of x, so x denotes here all the tuple of variables, and we take the sign of p2 of x, and so on, up to the sign of pm of x. So this is this thing is a vector in plus minus 1 to the m, because I'll not allow, okay, maybe I say. So x is in Rn, and I don't want zeros, although you could allow zeros and then there will be something, but let's not allow zero now. So Pix is not zero for all I. Okay, so this is a definition of some set of vectors, and we count how many of them we have. Okay, so this is a. And you see that this is obviously it's at most the number of connected components of the semi-variety of all x's, so that all the PIX are not zero, right? So we can bound it by the number of connected components, and people in algebraic geometry, in real algebraic geometry, know to bound connected components. In fact, any Betti numbers, but the specific thing that I want here is a theorem by Warren. Although in the old papers, we, with Frankel and Redel, we were not aware of this, so we used some other things of Milner and Thom, and then you have to be a little bit more clever. Here it will just be to plug in this. So this is from the late 60s, 68. It says that if m is at least n, and the degree of each pi, let's say, really we care about the sum of the degrees, but the degree of each pi is at most k, then the number of sign patterns is not so big. So it is most some constant, 4 times e, times the total degree, so m times k, that's the sum of the degrees of all the polynomials, divided by n raised to the power n. Okay, so it's it's useful only if m is significantly bigger than n, because you see, if m is significantly bigger than n, no matter what the degree is, so if the degree, even if the degree is also n, then this behaves only like n to the n, and not like 2 to the m. Maybe m is n squared or something, which would have been much, much bigger. Okay, so this is n. D, is there a D somewhere?
Okay.
K, yeah. Okay. So Good. So this is, so maybe I'll show you how the proof is in two line. So proof of this result from the paper with Frankel and Redel that f of n, the maximum sign rank of an n by n matrix, is at least omega n. Okay, why is it true? Because if f of n is, let's say, d, okay, d will be, then number yeah, I'm not sure, right, yeah. If f of n is equal r, then any sign matrix is a sign, is given by signs of n square quadratic polynomials with two n, any sign n by n. So n square quadratic polynomials with two n r variables, right? Because just we have this n by r times r by n matrix. These are the variables. And then every entry here is just the product of the scalar product of this by this, which is a quadratic polynomial. So that's a quadratic polynomial. We have two Rn variables. So the number, so number of them by Warren is at most a constant for En square times two divided by two N R raised to the power 2Rn. And if this captures all the sign matrices, it has to be at least 2 to the n squared. Right? And then we just solve, so R here has to be at least constant n. Okay, so there is nothing much to do here. And basically the same, or essentially the same, would work for a given VC dimension. We only have to find many sign matrices of small VC dimension. Okay, so let me show in the same way that Fn2 is at least a omega n to the 1 half over log n. This was one that we wanted, okay. So basically a finite projective plane, of order n plus 1, so this means that every line contains n plus one points, every point lies in n plus one lines, is or gives. If I look at the incidence matrix of the lines and points, then it will give me an n, which is n squared plus n plus one, that's the number of points and lines, by n binary matrix. It's more convenient to look at binary matrix with many ones, so with roughly, well, with more than n to, okay, maybe with 1 plus little of 1, n to the 3 half ones. Right, in every row we have n plus 1, little n plus 1 points. So that's a total number of ones. And no, no 2 by 2 matrix or submatrix of ones, because through any 2 points we have just one line. We don't have two lines. Okay. So that means, yeah. Now I take all the submatrices. So I'm allowing to replace every ones by zero. So every, not all the sub, or every matrix smaller or equal than this in each coordinate, So it's still binary. Afterwards, we replace it to a sign matrix, right? But so every such matrix, I'm saying that has a VC dimension, at most two, because you see, to have VC dimension three, you have to have 1, 1, 1. I mean, of course, now it's a VC dimension of binary matrix instead of sign matrices, but we can make the adjustment. So if we want VC dimension three, then we need the one row is 1, 1, 1, another row is 1, 1, 0. So we have to have a 2 by 2, which we don't have in any. Okay, so all of those are of VC dimension. At most two, and there are 2 to the 1 plus 1, n to the 3/2 of them. So as before, by the same Moran, so if R is this Fn2, then we know that 4e times n squared times 2 divided now by 2nr raised to the 2nr is bigger than 2 to the 1 plus little 1 n to the 3/2. And this gives us that this is 2. So this is essentially n, what you see here. And it's n to the nr, so you get that r is at least n to the 1/2 over log n. Okay, so this is now the others I'll not show, because for each of them we would need something. So you know, you have to generate these many matrices with VC dimension, but it's believable. So this one is some probabilistic argument that you do by something, and this one actually comes from either one of those projective norm graphs or some construction of Brown. So there are some constructions from those, and the ones that I raised with general D also comes from something probabilistic. But the only thing is to generate a lot of matrices with given VC dimension, and a lot of matrices just means are just obtained by generating one matrix which is somewhat dense and taking every smaller or equal matrix in it. And I should say, by the way, that the proof of the upper bound works, as you saw, not only for bounding VC dimension, but for any matrix in which what is called the primal Schetter function, the number of projections that you have on any k columns, is at most k to the d times some constant. So you could ask for this, and for this, this would be tight always up to the logarithmic factor because of those constructions of what is called projective norm graphs. So there was some construction by Kolar, Ronia, and Szabo, and then I had some paper with Ronia and Szabo. So this also uses some algebraic geometry, which basically gives you a very dense matrix, which has some nice properties. And that's maybe another reason to think that that the n to the 1 minus 1 over d should be the truth always. Yeah, so it's related to Zarankevich, although if you want this, so Zarankevich, problem is finding the densest possible matrix you can without a submatrix of one, an S by T submatrix of ones. And we're doing it slightly more careful here. So you could use Zarankevich and it would give you something, but if you want the best bounds, then you should somehow adjust and see what is better for you. But it's similar, right? Yeah. So we want, okay. So now we want to say something about the explicit. This Foster, and we have to decide what we can prove and what we prove and what I want. I had this say. So when we had this paper with Frankel and Redel, so it gave, there was, as I said, this paper by Patry and Simon about unbounded error communication complexity, and they ask what is the maximum possible sign rank of an n by n matrix. So they knew it is log, and this shows that it is constant n. And I went, I was in MIT at the time, so a postdoc, and I went to talk in Cornell, remember? And actually Simon was there, so he was visiting, and I didn't know him before. On the other hand, Peter Frankel was one of the co-authors, and Peter is also Hungarian, and so he told me that this is Hungarian, so it should be Janusz Simon, because that's the way you should pronounce it in and then I gave this talk in Cornell, and I said, Paturi and Simon, and I, so I said it several times, and after a while, people told me that, you know, you should call him Simon, and I said that, yes, but my Hungarian friends tell me that that this is pronounced Simon, but they said, but you see, he's here, and this is how he pronounces it, so, okay, and then later in the lecture, I had some, I was talking about some simplex, and so I said the simplex, just to make a point, and of course, yeah, I think they liked it. But, okay, so I still, they didn't complain, right, yeah. So it is, anyway, but, okay, so we want to say something about the explicit, and let me see. So there is the following theorem. This is due to Forster. And it is slightly modified what I write here, but this modification is also this is what the proof gives, and I think it is also mentioned in as a remark in one of those papers, one of the subsequent papers of Forster. So it says the following: that if A again is n by n, and Aij is a, so it's a sign matrix. And now we have some matrix, say, Mij, so M is also N by N, and Mij, it has the right signs, times Aij, but not only does it have the right signs, also it has entries that are somewhat big. So it is, at least, in particular, I could have taken M equals A, but I don't want to take. In the original result of Forster, he takes M equals A, but I want to allow something slightly more general. If this is the case, then it implies that the sign rank of A is at least N over just the norm of M. So it's the usual L2 norm, the maximum of Mx over all unit vectors. So this is true, and this is not, okay, I'll show you the proof of that, although this takes the risk that maybe I'll not show some of the details later, but maybe I will, yeah. I mean, as I said, everything here is short, so I'll show you proof. This is essentially Forster proof, only I'll use his, lemma, so this will not prove. That's a nice lemma. So that's a thing I mentioned yesterday. So this is about this isotropic position. So yes, the following, if if V1 up to Vn are in R, let me call them X1. Up to xn are in Rk, and in general position. So by general position, I mean that every k of them are linearly independent. Okay, so every k linearly independent, then there is a non-singular B, matrix B, which is K by K, which puts the X's in what is called isotropic position, that if we look at the sum of BXI times BXI transposed, I go from 1 to N, So this is the outer product, right? We've seen the outer products. So it's a product of a column vector by row vector. Each of them is a k by k matrix. Then this is n over k times the identity. Okay, and the proof of this is by some iterative procedure. He's basically using compactness. He kind of shows that whenever this is not the case, you can improve it. And because, you could say, you could describe it in a more algorithmic way. But it's a, it's a nice limit. It's not, it's short, but it's kind of mysterious. Or I don't know. I mean, maybe. It will be nice to. Okay, and let me show you how his lemma implies his theorem or this modified theorem. So proof of theorem. Okay, so suppose it's better to. Okay, maybe let me write. Suppose A is this, I want to say the indices will not be ij, because otherwise it will confuse things. So let me write it axy, where x, so these are just indices. X is in x, y is in y. There will be some abuse of notation here, but I think you'll get it. And these are sets of cardinality n. Okay, so these are just the ways that I want to denote these things. And suppose that the sign rank of A, let it be K. Okay, so this is K. So then what it means is that then this means that there exist vectors, X1, there exist vectors, okay, there exist X and Y, which are subsets in RK. These are the rows and the columns of these matrices. And we know that the sine of x transposed y, they give us the correct signs. So this is A x y. Right, so this is just to say that the sine rank is k. I'm just okay. And now I'm saying, so first I can assume that without loss of generality, x in general position. Because we can perturb it if we need, right? I mean, the signs will stay the same, so we can assume that it is in general position. And then I claim that, in fact, without loss of generality, I can apply the B. So, okay, so by lemma, may assume, in fact, that that x is 1 for all, so they are all unit vectors, and they satisfy this, and the sum of the outer products, x transpose, so now they are unit vectors, this is n over k times I. Why? Because we just, so this is over x and x. Because we just replace the x's by bx over normalized, and the y's by b minus 1 or b transpose minus 1, so replace x by this bx over bx, and y by, I think that's the right thing, is b transpose there. Minus 1, y. So just the products will stay the same. Okay, and also normalize. And now assume also that every y is 1 for all y and y. We just care about the signs. I mean, there is no problem. So they are all unit vectors and the x's. I want to use. That's right. Yeah. So it is okay. Now we do the following. So we define some quantity d, which is just the sum over all x and y, so little x in capital X, little y in capital Y, of a m, this matrix m, now, xy, times the inner product, x transpose y. And now we will find an upper bound for D and a lower bound for D, and we will compare them, and we'll get the statement of the theorem, and then we'll see how much time we'll have for that. Okay, so the upper bound. So what is D? That's kind of nice. So this is the sum. I just write here the definition of inner product. So this is the sum as I goes from 1 to k. And here we have the sum over all x in x and y in y of m x y x I y I, right? Because we have to sum over all the. And this is, if you think about it, this sum is 1, I goes from 1 to k. And here we have really as a quadratic form, so we have the vector x I transpose, but think about it now as a I is fixed now. So xi is a vector of length n for all the x's, and times a m times the vector of the yj's, if you want, of the yi again, times this, right? So, but again, I'm saying this is a vector indexed by the x's of length capital N. This is also a vector of length capital N. And we have n such sums. But this is now a quadratic form, so we can bound it by the norm. So we have sum I and k. So this is not more than the norm of m times the norm of this vector of the xi's, which is the sum over all xi square over x in x, times the same thing for y. Y times square. Okay, so this is and this now we use again Cauchy-Schwarz. So you see that here we have some, well, the m goes outside, and we have a sum of k things, and each of these things is something times something. So we can take the sum of squares times the sum of squares, and we take the square root. And if you look what this is, so this is a sum I from 1 to k of the sum x in x of xi square, square root, and the same thing for y. The sum I from 1 to k, the sum y in y of yi square. And this is just n, because they are unit vectors. So this is n, and this is n, square root. And so this is m times n. That's the upper bound. Now the lower bound is simpler. So the lower bound, D, again, is sum of mxy, x transpose y, okay? But you see, mxy has the right sign. It has the same sign as x transpose y, and it is at least one also. So that means that this is, at most, the sum now, the sum is over all xy of x transpose y, absolute value. Because we have the right signs, and we are in absolute value, we are at least one. So this is it for equality. Okay, never mind. As I told you, it really gives more. So for Hadamard matrix, it gives that it's more than square root n, because we cannot have equality all the time. Never mind. Now these are unit vectors, so their inner product is at most one, and therefore the absolute value of it is at least the square of it. We square a number, which is at most one. And this we can write again. So this is just a number square. I can write it as, x transpose y is the same as y transpose x, just a number. So this is y transposed x times x transposed y. And we can put the brackets as we wish. So this is really the sum as y goes to y of y transposed. And here we have the sum over all x in x of x x transpose. And I can put the brackets as I want. And this is times y. And here we use the fact that those are in isotropic position. So this is a sum, is y and y. This sum is n over k. So we have here y transpose and y. I mean, it's identity. That's y is y. So this is really n square over k, because each y is a unit vector. OK, and that means that we proved that n square over k is at most n, n. And that gives us that k, which is the sign rank, this is what we cared about, is at least n over m. So this is what we wanted. That's basically the proof of Foster. Okay. So now let's see how it gives us the theorem, this theorem there. Proof of theorem. Okay, so we have this matrix, this binary matrix A, and we have the sign matrix 2A minus J, and now we just have to find this matrix M. Did I, what happened to the theorem is here? So I want to use this. I want to use this theorem, right? Maybe I'll write in some other place. OK, so we want to define M. Let's keep the theorem here. And we want to define M, so we will just shift. I guess I should have written something here just to be. So let me assume that delta is at most n over 2. I don't want that the degree of regularity will be too big. OK. So again, we start proof. So I could do that. So we have the theorem there. OK, so define M will be what? It will be N over D times A minus J. Right, so this is somehow, it makes sense. I mean, M over delta, right? Correct. So N over delta A times J, because I want to kill the biggest singular value, and then I. Okay, so just note that that this is okay, that indeed M, okay, now I denote it again by ij, Mij times 2a minus j, that's a sign matrix. Ij, because what happened here, so everything that was zero will become, was zero in A, would be minus one here, which is okay. Everything that was one here, now it will be n over delta, which is at least 2, because delta is at most n over 2. And we subtract 1, so it's at least 1. It will be positive and at least 1, maybe much more than 1. Okay. So this is at least 1. OK, so we can. And then the only thing is that we want to see is that the norm of m is small. OK, but this is because now we have m, so let x be a unit vector. And we write x as x1 plus x2, with x1 will be some constant of the all one vector, which really, and x2 is orthogonal to x1. Okay, so x is a unit vector, at least one. And now we have to show that this mx inner product with mx is not too big. So I write now inner product like that. Okay, but the important thing is that the mx1 is zero, right? Because this is all one vector. So this was delta times n over delta is n and j. So this is zero. So what's left here is really just mx2. Mx2, And again, what's left from X2 is, because X2 is orthogonal to J, so this is N over delta A, X2, N over delta A, X2. So we have here N square over delta square, and we really have just A, X2, norm square, but this is a vector orthogonal to the biggest, so this is at most sigma 2 square. N square over delta square, sigma 2 square. And that implies that the norm of M is at most N over delta sigma 2. So what we get from a theorem by Forster, modified Forster's, by theorem, we know that sine rank of this 2A minus J, just the sine version of the binary matrix A, is at least N divided by N over delta times sigma 2, which is delta over sigma 2. This is what we wanted, right? OK, now just one example. So it is actually what I have here still. So we want one explicit example. Of course, we know that we have many examples of graphs that are good, regular graphs, or even symmetric matrices with big spectral gap, right? So we can take, but let me take specifically this projective plane again. So again, a projective plane, finite, right? Finite, projective plane of order n plus 1. This gives us a binary matrix, binary n. So we already said it before, but by n matrix, which is n plus 1 regular. Let's call the matrix A, as before. So it is n plus 1, our delta is n plus 1. And let's compute, I mean, here, because it's a projective plane, it's very simple to compute A transpose A. So in the diagonal, we have the number of 1s in every row. So this is n plus 1, like this. And in any other place, we have the number of common points of two lines, which is 1, right? So we have 1 everywhere else. And therefore, we know what the eigenvalues of this. Sigma 1 square is n plus 1 square. This is true always for every regular, just the sum of entries here. And all the others, you see that in this matrix, if you subtract n on the diagonal, then you get a matrix of rank 1. So all the other eigenvalues of this matrix are n. OK, so sigma 2 square is already, and all the others say exactly little n. So it means that sigma 2 is a square root of n, which is about the fourth root of capital N. So we know that the sine rank of this projective plane, I mean, it's again 2a minus j, because we just make it, is at least a delta over sigma 2, which is a, you know, just little 1, n to the 1 quarter. So it's 1 quarter. It's not as big as n to the 1 half, as a counting argument, but because what? It's actually an interesting problem for this specific example. What is a real sine rank of that? I don't know. I mean, if you think about it, it's not more than n plus 1 because then it's, again, the number of sign changes, what we used before. Along every column here, the number of sign changes you have is like 2n plus 1 or something, because you have only n plus 1 positive and the other negative. So the sign rank is between little n and between square root of little n, between n to the 1/4 and n to the 1/2. Maybe it's even, I don't know, maybe it's even close to, right. And then, as I said, so I'll not write it, but we have many examples, so you can take projective geometries of higher dimension. You also suggested to do that, and you can take all kinds of constructions of Ramanujan graphs. So you can even have things that not only will the VC dimension be only 2, but you can make it even sparse with respect to that. You can take a graph with a girth at least 10 or something. So on every 3 coordinates, not only you will not see all the 8 possibilities, but in fact, you will not even see 7. You will see only 6 of them, just because there are no short cycles. So you can see, and still the bound would be some power, maybe n to the 1 over 8 or something. So it would be all kinds of. And maybe I'll just write 2 problems, and this will finish. So I mentioned, yeah, that so one thing is FnD, this maximum signed rank of an n by n matrix with VC dimension D. Is it indeed theta of n to the 1 minus 1 over d for all d? And if you don't want, I mean, yeah, if you want, you can put, you can allow log factors, then we would know that it's true at least for d equals 2, right? But I think that the reasonable conjecture would be that even you don't need the log here. And as I said, up to log, this will be true if you change the definition of f and d. Well, one way is to change the definition of f and d to be this function. But if you change it to be the maximum possible sign rank of an n by n matrix with primal Schetter function, at most some constant k to the d, and that would be the truth. And in this second one, maybe for this projective plane, what is sine rank of this 2a minus j, and a is a incidence matrix of projective plane. And we know that, so is it closer to the upper bound, which is to theta of n, or to this theta of square root n. So the lower bounds and the upper bounds are n and square root n. And if it's close to this, then it's a maximum that we could have. So just you mean just right, yeah, this is true, right? So they have a paper with also with Amir and Zev, and Zev, right, yes, it gives some so indeed if I mean, I should say also that people looked quite a bit also at a sign rank or the sign rank of matrices that have zeros also, and you insist on leaving the zeros as zeros and keeping the signs, and then of course there are matrices that have full rank. But there are also lots of questions there. For example, right? Yeah. Yeah, but you see that here really, so like the identity matrix, which if you look at the sign rank version in the ways that I look, so positive on the diagonal, negative everywhere else, then three, right? So it just the sign rank is three. And all and the diagonal things are also. So really, there is a big difference. Yeah, maybe it's a. Okay, so I. So in fact, I still have a lot of. So we still have like 5 minutes for questions and. But, or. Okay.